To another show, The Weekly Rant, alongside Steve. I'm Jimmy.
Yep.
And this is actually our first show since Old Tree Pub was kind enough to actually have us. We want to thank them again for our NFL pregame show back on December 1st. That was a big day for us. And again, special thanks to you guys. Thank you very much.
Yeah, the service was great. Thanks to everyone who came out. We had about 80 people. It was really a great show. And you know, Jimmy, your Dolphins pick may actually be correct, but you know, we'll wait for Wednesday on that one.
I know. We're not doing football tonight, folks. Sorry.
Yeah, so if you guys don't want to listen to us talk about baseball, hockey, cricket, curling, horseback riding, water polo, this is not the right day for you. But you know, before we begin, we'll talk about Army Navy a little later, but you and I made a bet on Saturday.
Yeah, I know. I don't see the jersey, so I'm happy.
Right oh, now. The jersey is right here. Don't worry about that. So, Jimmy and I made a bet. If Navy were to win by 13 or more... Which was the spread. Jimmy would be forced to wear an Islanders Alexei Yashin jersey.
Who they're still paying.
Who they are still paying until the end of time. Him and Rick DiPietro.
Yes.
And if Army would have won, or any other result would have occurred, I would have worn a Super Bowl Giants Plaxico Burress jersey.
They just fired Ellison, Army head coach.
Yes, they did. I thought I would mention that a little later. That's
all right. Well, I'm just trying to stay.
But since Navy won 35-7 in a game in which I think I could have put 7 points up on Army. Jimmy, this jersey is for you.
Gonna vomit right now.
Wear it proudly, you dirty Russian.
It's terrible. Oh god, it smells like losses.
I farted in it too.
Yeah, they stink.
Hey, at least it fits. Your mother would be so proud of you.
Oh my god.
Oh that looks awesome. anyone who's watching live, please. Take pictures and post it on Facebook immediately. And if you want to find us on Facebook, you can at facebook.com/Jimmy's Rants. We're on Twitter at twitter.com/Jimmy's Rants. If you want to call us today, 609-975-9689. And I made it. Yeah, 609-975-9689. If you want to talk to us about anything in the wide world of baseball, hockey, basketball, cricket, college basketball, college football, curling, water polo, horse polo, roller hockey, whatever kind of polo, whatever you want.
Yep.
We are going to be okay. Let's get on with it. We're talking some baseball. And the big story, since we've been out.
Well, we've been out two weeks. Out. Yeah.
How are you feeling? You feeling a little better?
I still feel like shit.
I'm glad that, whatever, I can't make that joke. We are on the, whatever. Your vagina's doing
jersey,
better.
This jersey's not helping right now. So we've been out about 2 weeks.
We missed a lot of moves in those two weeks.
We really did.
And, you know, none being bigger than Robinson Cano signing a 10-year, $240 million contract with Seattle. But I think the best part about it was how he felt insulted.
He did feel insulted.
By a 7-year, $175 million offer that the Yankees gave him.
And all those tweets that were going out, too, about it?
Mm-hmm.
Unbelievable. I don't understand. I really do. I really do understand what was going on.
I think we got a caller pretty quickly. Hello, you're on the air. Hello?
Yes?
Hi, you're on the air with Jimmy and Steve.
Hi. I would like to know if you know anything about horseshoes.
About horseshoes, yes. It's the only thing that comes close is in horseshoes and hand grenades, right?
Yes, really, and cigars.
Yes, and cigars.
And cigars.
Yeah, it's an Islanders jersey.
A bet's a bet. I had to go through with it. He lost.
We're having a little bit of difficulty here. If you want to try to call back in, we're having a little bit of a problem here with our connection. But anyway, so as we were just talking about the Robinson Cano deal, it was one that really struck up the world of sports. That day was a big day in itself because a lot of stuff went on. It wasn't just the Robbie Cano. It was also Curtis Granderson going over to the Mets. It was, Bartolo Colon happened about a week later.
I think there was 13 trades that happened on that Tuesday.
Trades or
just
trades.
Just trades. On that Tuesday, which Cano and Granderson, there was 13 trades.
Right.
Not to mention all the free agent signings.
Now, the previous caller, we were having a little bit of trouble, difficulty there. If you want to call back in, feel free. Again, the phone number to anybody who wants to call in is 1-609-975-9689. Now, the Robbie Cano deal, 10 years, $240 million. Now, the Yankees had offered him 7 years, and they bumped it up last minute to $170 million.
I thought it was 175.
Was it 175?
It was 175. It's 25 a year.
Now, in Yankees money, I guess the 175 is okay. But in the real world, I don't even think he's worth the 175. I mean, he's trying to draw, unfortunately, to say it, A-Rod money. You're not going to get A-Rod money out of someone who can only play the field. Quite frankly, I think Brandon Phillips is a better second baseman anyways.
I think
and so. He's not going to get that money from them anyways.
They wouldn't. They had no problem with the Phillips for Gardner deal. They just want to pay him more money on that 4-for-52 deal.
And I wish they would have. I really, really wish they would have. But as far as that Robbie Cano deal, $240 million? For what? For what?
Well,
the guy doesn't hustle.
You're right.
That's my number one thing in baseball. To me, baseball's a lazy man's sport.
It definitely is. It's not a team sport either.
No, it's not. And if you're not going to hustle, forget about it, because that's a sport really where if you want to shine other than hitting those home runs, hustle, show some grit, show some determination that you want to play for this team.
Yeah, but Joe McEwing's not winning World Series.
He's not going to.
Dustin Pedroia, he does win World Series, but he's got Big Poppy right behind him. Robinson Cano is, as much as I hate him, and I really do, and I would never want him on the Mets, but he is the best second baseman in Major League Baseball. He puts up the numbers. He hits over 300. He hits 25 homers every year.
As a whole, I'm not going to argue that. I meant just defensively.
He's one of the best defensive second basemen in the league. His three Gold Gloves shows that.
Right. I like Phillips better. Hux just came off of a Gold Glove season.
Yes, but Brandon Phillips, I like him. He tweets too much. He's too out there in social media and real life. And he had a horrible year. Everyone forgets. Brandon Phillips had his worst year as a Major League Baseball player last year. And going to Yankee Stadium is great. When you're a lefty. When you're a righty, it's not that great for you. The advantage of being a right-handed hitter in Yankee Stadium, it doesn't play that well. Cincinnati plays in Great American Ballpark, which is one of the best hitter parks in Major League Baseball. And Brandon Phillips really is. He's a great second baseman, but you know, he's not worth more than the $13 million a year he's getting. But now back to Cano.
13, 14, 15.
Yes.
It goes up. Yeah, 16, I think. So
yeah, you're right. Now, back to Cano, though. I think he's worth every penny. For Seattle, he is absolutely worth every penny of that $10,240. He actually, the night before he signed, Jay-Z called up and said, Seattle, if you give him 9 years, we'll sign. Seattle goes out, or Jay-Z flies out there, and he's like, I want that 10th year. And the CEO of Seattle, Armstrong, walked out of that room screaming, saying, no way in hell. And 10 hours later, they gave him that 10th year. You know, Cano wants security. He's 31 years old. This is his last contract.
Yeah.
He's getting $24 million a year. People rip on him for saying, when he said in his press conference, I actually turned down money to come to the Mariners. You know what? Technically, he did. He turned down $1 million per year because he's making $24 million a year, in which the year average salary for the Yankees would have been $25 a year. So he technically did turn down money. Granted, at ages 38, 39, and 40, would he have made $24 a year? Probably not. But You know, I'm not against this. I really think it's a good deal for Seattle, but they can't stop there.
Yep.
This cannot be it for him, for them.
He would have made close to the same amount. And close to, I would say, probably upwards of about over 200 if he stayed with the Yankees.
Mm-hmm.
However, he would have had to have done more work. Now, everybody's saying, you're an idiot. He was just offered 175.
Well, everyone says that anyway.
Right, I know that. But for once, I'm going to explain myself. When you're playing in New York, when you're Robbie Cano, you're really on a good side, the face of the New York Yankees. A bad side would be A-Rod, and an outgoing side would be Derek Jeter. But as the face of the Yankees, if you will, you're playing in New York media, you're going to get those outside contracts. The Gatorades, the Nikes, all these other companies are going to want to sponsor you and do all that. You're going to have to work more, do more commercials. The difference here is Robbie is now not going to have to do anything else because that's coming in his contract. And if he wants to make any more money outside in Seattle, first of all, they're not going to pay him as much for those contracts in Seattle.
He's got Nintendo.
What?
Nintendo's based out of Seattle.
What? Really?
Yeah. The right. CEO of the Mariners used to be Nintendo.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Nice.
Learned something new every day, right?
I didn't know that, yeah. Through you, who'd have thought?
Not, well. Well, what you can learn from me.
Anyway. Welcome back, Ding. Yes,
yeah,
love it.
Yeah, yeah.
Now Robbie has had a career and a half. You know, so far coming up since 2006, he's been batting already over 300. The guy's hit over 200 home runs. He's playing really well. He's playing better than any second baseman really ever has. He's projected to become the best second baseman all around. So when you say he's worth the money, I agree with you. When you say he's worth the money, when you refer to Seattle. To the Yankees, he's not worth the money.
Well, look at what the Mets did back in 2005. They signed Carlos Beltran to that 7-year, $119 million contract. The same Pedro Martinez to a 4-year, $52 million contract.
But the first year Beltran panned out, he had 41 home runs. He looked great for you guys.
Second year. But yeah, he looked
in 2006.
Great in 2006. But
right.
Everyone said when the Mets signed Pedro Martinez, was 4 years, $52 million really worth it? He only gave you 2.5 years. Abso-frickin-lutely. Pedro Martinez made the Mets a respectable. Yes, I said respectable. And they were. They were in 06, a respectable franchise.
Well, from there on out, they only play until the All-Star game.
Oh.
Thank you, Phillies.
No problem. But they were a respectable franchise because of that contract. Sometimes it takes money to make money, and that's my motto when I gamble in Vegas. So, you know, it's true. I don't really make money in Vegas. But, you know, it's okay. I know.
Sorry, thinking about that one.
Yeah, I said that really softly. Can you guys hear me out there? No? Good. Moving on. But like I said, Seattle can't stop there. They got to go more. They got to get Nelson Cruz. They got to trade for David Price. If Robinson Cano is your only offseason attraction, you're going to fail. They signed Corey Hart to a 1-year, $6 million contract, but he's fresh off 2 knee surgeries. They traded for Logan Morris, and they traded a middle reliever that no one cares about in Carter Capps.
Now, let me ask you this real quick. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but...
Yeah, you should be sorry.
I don't know. I say that softly, too. Yeah, year in and year out, the past give or take 3 years, that made no sense. The Yankees have been trying to go after Felix Hernandez.
Not going anywhere.
Okay, now, although they had lost Robbie in free agency, does it in any way, shape, or form bring some sort of friendship, if you will, to be able to deal Felix? Or are they now going to look at it as, we have our pitcher. We have our king batter, our key batter. Why are we going to lose a pitcher now?
They
already lost Pineda, who hasn't done a thing for the Yankees.
They didn't really lose Pineda. They traded Pineda to Montero, who also did nothing for the Mariners.
Which I'm happy about, because he was supposed to be some great... Why am I wearing this jersey?
You lost the bet.
Oh, I look down and see orange.
I think you may get hives after the show's over. You dirty brush.
I'm not going to stop that. It's all right, you're paying me.
Paying you what?
I don't know. I'm playing the dirty Russian's role.
Yeah, that's true. I told you, I was going to dress just as bad just to make you look better, but I still can't do that.
Great. Well, look what you're doing. You're wearing a 1985
86
Mets David Wright, who didn't even play for them in 86.
They had a one-game deal in which they all wore these jerseys to commemorate.
And they still lost. And you're wearing a doofy hat. And who's that autographed by?
Ruben Tejada, the best Met ever.
Did you pay for anything with that?
No. My season ticket holder broker gave it to me.
So you paid for the season tickets.
Well, I also got a Matt Harvey autographed baseball.
You can go to a Ranger game because Matt Harvey at least watches some winning team.
Really? You consider that winning?
Of all the teams in New York right now, Yes.
The Red Bulls, actually.
We're going to move past Cano now. We're going to move past Cano.
You never let me finish my point on Cano and the Mariners. But
go ahead,
okay.
go ahead, finish it.
They can't stop. Just like Miley said, we won't stop. Okay, now we can move on.
Wow, I almost felt bad. Like, wow, I'm an idiot. Wow, really? Oh, God. I was going to say, where do you want to go? But I'll just take this. I know you want to go with Jabba and Phil Hughes.
I really didn't. I just wanted to mention them all.
I didn't want to talk about them at all, but Jabba Chamberlain goes to Detroit Tigers.
They have
Thank you.
They have good trampoline parks there.
Oh, I love that one. Bust the other ankle. Phil Hughes to the Minnesota Twins. Phil Hughes to the Minnesota Twins, I think, is so fitting. The Twins cannot beat the Yankees to save their life. So why not have Phil Hughes, who Phil Hughes can't beat anybody anyways, just join them? Why not?
Phil Hughes, I would have liked to see Phil Hughes on the Mets. Hughes actually pitched much better than his numbers kind of indicated, considering he did pitch in Yankee Stadium. And he got 3 years. No, he got 2 years. He got 2 years from Minnesota. I think he's going to do well. He's going to a big ballpark and Target, and he's not going to have to be in the AL East. He may face the Yankees every so often, but he's getting to face the Royals.
They've faced him 12 times this year. I looked that up before.
The Royals, the Indians. I mean, not the best powerhouse offenses.
Oh, Royals are pretty good now.
Yeah, but they don't have the offense.
No, they don't. But anybody, a three-year-old, can hit off of Phil Hughes. Phil Hughes reminds me, actually, of A.J. Burnett. When A.J. Burnett pitched for the Yankees...
And look at what A.J. Burnett did last
year. Hang on a second. I have reasons for that one, too. When A.J. Burnett pitched for the Yankees, everybody knew him as he cannot get out of the first two outs without giving up a run. We have another caller.
Wow, people really want to talk about baseball. You're on with Jimmy and Steve.
How you doing?
Hey, this is John from Florida.
Hey, John, what's going on? How are you?
Hey, yeah, I didn't know if you guys were talking about hockey. I wanted to talk about the Rangers. I watched them play last night.
I'm so sorry.
It's the same thing with the Rangers all the time, I feel like, even with a different coach. They really only have one player who I think can score at any time, and that's Nash. And, you know, they're not a deep team every year. Like, you know, like Detroit or someone like that, where they've got two or three lines of guys that, you know, can score any time on the ice. They're way too reliant on one or two guys. You know, Nash, it just came back. Richards, you know, over the hill. Backlund stands, but not really a goal scorer, you know. And, I just wanted to say that about the Rangers. Their defense is weak. Obviously, Delgado is having a terrible year. And there's always been a team that relies way too much on Lundqvist. And, you know, Lundqvist is playing... Not you know, at the top level, but still having an okay year so far, and I don't think they're gonna really make the playoffs. I think they're gonna end at 500. I know what you guys thought about that.
Well, as far as the Rangers go, I think Lundqvist right now, just like last year, he's having a bad start to the season. He's gonna come around. I think he's gonna play much better down the stretch. It was proven actually through stats that any team come Thanksgiving that's in the playoffs, 1-8, chances are actually in the playoffs at the end of the season. Rangers are at the bottom of the barrel. Good luck seeing the Rangers there. As far as their defense goes, Delzato, I would love to see Delzato off the team. But you mentioned Hagelin. Hagelin is, being that he's the fastest player in the NHL, arguably behind Kreider, actually. That's a player you need on the team, because when you put him on a line, especially with Brad Richards, and Brad Richards is actually, unfortunately, the Rangers' leading goal scorer, assists, and total points, obviously if you win in those two categories. The Rangers have trouble scoring. That's a known fact right there. And as far as with Alain Vigneault, right now they lost Callahan. When you lose Callahan, that's a key player you cannot lose.
Don't you always lose Callahan? It's always it's every other week. Callahan breaks his pinky. Callahan breaks his leg. Callahan breaks his head. Callahan breaks this. Breaks that.
And another thing I wanted to bring up is how you mentioned Callahan. I thought about it earlier today when I was watching them last night. I know they're missing Callahan. And Callahan is a really good leader. Definitely does everything the right way. But I don't know any other team other than that has a forward, especially as their captain, who, you know, isn't really a consistent scorer. Like, you know what I mean? Like, a lot of teams, when they have that solid defenseman as the captain, they're, you know what I mean? They're obviously the best defenseman, one of the best defensemen in the league. But, you know, it just goes, it points more to the fact how much the Rangers really, I think, have a problem scoring every year. The fact that, you know, even their best player, the guy that they need the most, still isn't really someone you can count on for scoring.
I don't think you should name your best player a captain. You're a captain for one reason. And believe it or not, as much as you talk, you know, badly about Callahan, and you're actually right with what you just said, I don't think there's a better captain in the league than Ryan Callahan. He's a guy who hustles game in and game out.
Is the guy wearing an Islander jersey?
Shut up for a minute. Notice we have a caller calling in about the Rangers and not the Islanders and not the Mets and not the Jets.
Remember our first caller ever was about the Islanders.
I know, that wasn't good. That wasn't good. But one thing I want to point out is a good point that you brought up with Detroit. Detroit is tough to compare to anybody only because Detroit has been known since the early 90s to have the deepest scouting system. They had the best scouting system. They can bring up anybody they want, and they will contribute. They will find a spot in the lineup, and they'll play very well. So Detroit's a tough spot to compare someone with. The Rangers, I don't think they're going to turn it around too much. They're going to stay in the thick of things. They'll find their way about into the playoffs. But anyways, thanks for your call. I really appreciate it. We're going to get back more into hockey later. We want to get actually back into what we were talking about with Phil Hughes.
Let's get off Phil Hughes.
Excellent. Thank God.
Let's go to the Yankees.
Because I started getting talking into about A.J. Burnett. Jeez.
Well, A.J. Burnett and Phil Hughes have a lot in common. They're both going to do really well once they leave the Yankees.
Look, I didn't write anything about the Mets.
Anyway, the New York Yankees have made a lot of moves this offseason, most notably not re-signing Cano. But they did sign Brian McCann to a 5-year, $85 million contract. Jacoby Ellsbury overpaid for a 7-year, $153 million contract. And last but not least, they got Carlos Beltran for 3 years, $45 million. And great, I get to listen to John Miller say Carlos Beltran the entire season.
Excellent.
Now, Beltran for $345, I like the move.
Say it right.
Beltran for $345.
That's what you're saying it the rest of his career.
Saying yes.
That way.
Beltran?
Yes.
All right.
Done.
Boom.
Sorry, I reached. I saw the colors on this jersey.
Really? You lost a bet. You know what?
Did you know my first jersey I ever owned was an Islanders jersey?
Was it a Fish Sticks jersey?
Did you know I also bought it in Manhattan?
You bought it?
No.
Your parents bought it?
Yeah. Manhattan Mall. I distinctly remember buying it as we were on the way to my first ever Rangers game, Rangers versus Hurricanes.
And I bought an Islanders jersey. Who was it?
No one. It was a blue jersey. When I was younger, I was a fan of collecting jerseys that I was actually given, but this is the first one I actually picked out when I wanted to go to a store. I picked out a blue Islanders jersey.
Do you still have it?
Probably in my garage somewhere.
All right. Should be hanging.
I would actually hang it if I could find it.
All right.
I'm a fan of the sport.
Would it still fit you?
No. God, no. It'd fit my arm.
Maybe. Nope. Anyway, so Beltran for $345. I think that's a great deal. Granted, it was signed immediately after Granderson signed that 4-year, $60 million contract. Something tells me that the Yankees should have just re-signed Granderson. And I'm not saying that to be mean. I'm saying that because Beltran,
yeah.
In 2 years, he's going to be 40 years old. He's not going to keep this up, kids. It's over. He's got a year left in his tank, maybe a second year if we're lucky. That third year is nothing. He wants that third year because he knows he's not getting that much money later on. Granderson's 32 years old, and we'll talk about him more when we talk about the Mets. But it's a great signing for this year, but I really don't know what the Yankees are really trying to prove. They signed Kuroda for a 1-year, $16 million extension. They're still missing pitching. Is CeCe Sabathia coming back?
No.
The second base situation's disaster. Who knows what the hell's happening with A-Rod? Derek Jeter, is he going to play? Probably not. Yeah. And now you have too many cooks in the kitchen.
I think your infield's going to actually, at some point, going to end up be playing more as Alfonso Soriano second base and Eduardo Nunez a shortstop.
Oh, God. Kill me now.
I can see them bringing him into the infield.
You're making Daniel Morgan play a good defensive second
base. They're outfielders. Ellsbury, Soriano, Beltran, Gardner, Wells, Suzuki.
I was just about to say that. They have too many cooks.
They really do. They really do. And what are you going to do? You know, I think Soriano will actually be open to the possibility of coming in the way they initially had brought him up into their system.
But he can't play defense. He makes Robinson Cano hustle. He makes Robinson Cano
that's
hustle.
Why he was hated so much in Chicago, actually. Because he doesn't hustle.
No.
But when you're forced to be put in the infield, he knows what New York media is like. You get a guy that's not going to hustle three games and make a fool of himself. I think he may realize where he came from.
He's 37 years old.
Maybe he can do something.
No.
How do you know that?
They don't have a bullpen. They haven't. You know what? I just don't understand what they've been doing this offseason.
They've been signing a bunch of future 40-year-olds.
They really have. Jacoby Ellsbury, 7 years, $153 million. He had one good season 3 years, 2 years ago.
It was 2007 when he had 214 hits.
No, it was 2011. He came like third in MVP. He was ridiculous. Oh, 7 he did that too. I didn't mean to ring the bell.
Yeah, you've proved nothing good here so far.
I think I proved
yes. I'm winning 3-0 right now.
No, I already got one. You dirty Russian.
Oh, damn it.
Anyway. 7 years, 153 for what? For 110 games a season?
For nothing.
You wasted your money. You should have given all that money to Robinson Cano.
Yeah.
You put him back at second base. You have Vernon Wells man center field. Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
You have Brett Gardner man center field. Take two. There we go. Much better. You have Soriano and Beltran on the right field and Soriano left field. And you're a much better team. Right now, you're missing a closer. I heard that the Yankees are interested in John Papelbon. How awesome would that be?
You know, actually, there was a
would you do an Irish jig in Yankee Stadium?
I don't have anything against Papelbon. The reason why I don't have anything against Papelbon is because Papelbon and Mariano don't hate each other. They have nothing against each other. Papelbon said he would love to fill the shoes for Mariano. No one will ever be able to fill the shoes of Mariano Rivera. I know your take on a closer as is. However,
are they great? The most viable position in all of baseball.
Yeah. He has already stated he would love to become a part of the New York Yankees. This is back when he was playing for the Red Sox.
All Red Sox want to play for the Yankees. Wade Boggs, Johnny Damon, Jacoby Ellsbury.
Babe Ruth.
You know, Nick, I will not fix my hat. Thank you for watching. I enjoy looking like this. If Jimmy's got to look like an ass, so will I.
That's teamwork at its finest.
Now I'll fix
first
that.
Time
there we go. I'll fix
God
my hat.
Damn it.
You know, before I continue, you know, I know we're not talking about football today, but my fantasy football team had one hell of a week.
Mine didn't.
I'm winning 157-76.
I lost by 100.
And I still have Calvin Johnson left to go tonight.
I lost by 100.
Jamal Charles. There we go. Moving on. Let's go Mets. So, the New York Mets have made a lot of moves this season also, but while they're slowly creeping up to respectability, not quite there yet, they made a few nice moves in which they could be, in a couple of years, contenders.
What? Please be a caller.
Nope, not a caller.
Damn, it's
contenders!
For what? To make their way past the All-Star game?
Yeah!
Okay!
They're going to get that this year. Chris Young, 1 year, 7.25. They signed Curtis Granderson to a 4-year, $60 million contract, and Bartolo Colon to a 2-year, $20 million contract. Now, Bartolo Colon signing was brilliant.
There's a new rivalry in baseball, by the way. It's who can lose more weight, CeCe Sabathia or Bartolo Colon?
I thought it was Steve and Jimmy.
That's true, too, and that didn't pan out so well when I asked you to order spanakopita for me tonight.
And that's why I only got a single serving.
Damn it. I should have said large.
You did say large.
Oh, did I?
Yeah,
I
ignored you.
Should have bought it for me.
No. Anyway. Bartolo Colon was a shrewd signing by Sandy Alderson. You know what? Matt Harvey's out for the year. They need a fifth star to replace him. Bartolo Colon was, I think, sixth in the Cy Young Award last year. He had a great season. He's been great for the past 2 years. He knows what it's like to pitch in New York. And he's going to fill in for Matt Harvey for that 1 year. So, I just lost my train of thought. Jimmy, what do you think about the Mets offseason signings? Sorry.
See me laughing? That's my opinion. Hang on.
Anyway, while he's blowing his nose on camera, disgusting. Curtis Granderson was an excellent signing by the Mets as well. You know what? You put him in left field. You have Juan Lagares in center, who's the best defensive center fielder you missed. And
that's... Yep.
Did I mention if you want to call us, our phone number is 609-975-9689. You can also find us on Facebook at facebook.com/... Jimmy's Rants or twitter.com/Jimmy's Rants, hashtag TWR.
I'm getting sicker as I wear this jersey.
Yeah, shut up.
Did you light that candle?
No, you did.
Oh.
Alrighty, Jimmy's losing his mind. That jersey's really getting the best of him. Let's get off the Mets for a few seconds. Let's go into our debate, and we'll come back to the Mets after the debate. Maybe that'll cheer you up.
I have less than a minute. That's all I need to give my opinion on the Mets. All
right, go.
They suck.
All right.
I don't think the Mets are going to be that great.
I don't think they're going to be that great either. I think they're building their way towards it. They made the right moves. They've signed the right players for now and the future. Bartolo Colon's going to be a nice bridge until Harvey comes back. They have Syndergaard and Montero.
I love Harvey. I'm looking forward to having Harvey back. I really, really am. I love watching him play.
I almost wore my orange shirts, but I didn't want to be that obnoxious. But they have Syndergaard and Montero waiting in the wings. Darno's going to be a good catcher.
I saw him and Harvey and Wheeler last night at the Rangers game.
I just saw Wheeler and...
Wheeler and Murphy.
Murphy, yeah.
Harvey was there too, as he always is. Debate. So, the date of the Habba. Go ahead.
All right, the debate for tonight is, you know, we decided that we've been doing a lot of sports recently. Well, not much because Jimmy's been a pansy the past few weeks and haven't been on the air.
I still can't breathe, all right? Come on, let's go.
The debate for this week is we're in the holiday season right now, and since we do have another show on Wednesday, you can watch another special edition of the Weekly Rant Wednesday at 8 p.m.
Yes.
We decided that our debate today is going to be, which is the best holiday movie? Jimmy, since you were almost riding the Dolphins so far, I'm going to start with you.
A lot of people have actually put Die Hard in there.
Really?
As a holiday movie.
No.
Just because of the end.
The snow. The snow, yeah.
The snow. That was it. They put that in as a holiday movie.
If that's the case, I'll put Star Wars because it looks like I'm driving through snow and I'm going in light years.
Friday, I decided, let me go to Walmart, because they have the best prices. Keep dropping and getting lower. I actually went to Walmart, and I picked up a bunch of Christmas movies. I picked up the combo pack of Home Alone 1 and 2. I got Fred Claus, Four Christmases, and...
Love Actually.
No. Put a cue in there. And Elf. I'm going to have to say, and put a thought into this, Chevy Chase's Christmas Vacation. I can't find a better holiday movie that beats it. Chevy Chase is known as one of the best comedians and the best actors from the late 80s to the early 90s. He makes this movie. And again, I'm keeping it short and sweet as you make fun of me and say, really? That's all you got?
No, that's actually not a bad argument. I do enjoy Christmas Vacation. Okay. But, come on. It's such a light movie. You know it's not... Bad Santa. Billy Bob Thornton.
Billy Bob Thornton.
Getting hammered at Santa Claus all rocking.
In the car.
And the sandwiches. Do you want another sandwich? Come on. How is that not the best holiday movie?
I love that little fat kid. But I mean, you know, everybody, especially little kids when they're 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years old, they love seeing people get hurt and they laugh. I'm 27. When I see Chevy Chase go into the attic, walk across the attic, and get hit in the face with 3 floorboards, and then punches open the vent on the side of the house, I still crack up. I love it. Whoever made it is a comedic genius. And then after that, Helen, his wife, pulls down in the attic. He falls straight through because he's sitting there watching home movies back from 1959. It is constant comedy, and there's truth to it to a lot of people who can compare and say, my family is hysterical. No one can put up my family. This is a true family Christmas movie that brings in some comedy to it.
If you enjoy watching slapstick humor, just watch Home Alone 1 and 2. You can watch all those. You can watch Marv and Harry get hit in the head with paint cans, bricks, poles, 2x4s, safes, chests, whatever. But, again, Bad Santa. You got the fat kid, you got the drunk Santa, you got the black elf. What else are you missing? And Phoenix, mind you. There's no snow.
Yeah.
There's no snow. It's one hell of a movie, and you know what? The 17-year-old...
You're forgetting the chocolate calendar.
Oh, I forgot. Yeah, all right, the chocolate... I actually have a chocolate calendar. Come on, it's great.
Oh, yes. The thing about Christmas Vacation, too, being that it brings the whole family spirit together, is you have people going out there from that movie, going out, cutting down their own Christmas tree like they've always wanted to do. So many families out there have always said, Let's be like what they did in Chevy Chase Vacation. Let's go out, chop down our own Christmas tree.
No one's saying that.
I said that a couple of weeks ago.
You're the only one.
Because I got the flu, and that never happened. Now, on top of that, you have one of the greatest actors, I think, today, as far as TV goes, Lil Russ, a.k.a. people now know him as Johnny Galecki, who is from, he's from Big Bang Theory.
He's also married with children.
Yes, right. He did that actually, I guess, that must have been during Christmas Vacation, because he was pretty young then as well.
Yeah. No, Christmas Vacation came first.
Okay. Now, with that movie, you got a bunch of families coming together, you have people shopping for one another, you have people coming over to their houses, as is every holiday. No matter what religion or race you are, it really shows true families coming together to celebrate their families and their holidays. One of my favorite parts ever is when you have a grandmother who's completely delirious and they ask her to say grace. She says she's died 3 years ago. I personally love that part as well. And they say the Pledge of Allegiance when they ask her to say grace. You got the tripping grandparents sitting down in their dining room, falling asleep to nothing, just all four of them snoring away. It really shows you what everything is like when you're a child. You watch it. I say to myself when I'm watching this, wow, this really reminds me of when I used to go to my grandparents' house. Everybody's passed out, either drunk or eating when they're sleeping, after eating their meals, everything. I love it. I really do love this movie. It's priceless.
Wow.
Done.
Alrighty. Now, before we move on, I just find it very insulting that you raved about a Christmas movie the entire way through. Now, for the Jews out there, and I'm going to get a lot of flack for this one.
I said holidays and religions a lot.
Yeah, but you just talked about Christmas Vacation. The best real holiday movie is Eight Crazy Nights.
Adam Sandler, I love that movie! I love it! I'm going to give you this thing. I would never give you any other ones.
There we go. Now, we still got a little more baseball talk before we
He don't handle his Scorpio Bowl! Come on, you knew that
I
one!
I only wish I had the Hanukkah song queued up and ready to go, but I don't have it downloaded, so not happening. Now, before we move on to hockey, I know we spoke a little Rangers before. And actually, John made a good point earlier before I get off. I actually mentioned that to you the day. I said Vigneault, Tortorella, they play the same shit because they're all crappy. It doesn't matter with the coach. It just matters. The players suck. But we'll talk about that in a few minutes. Baseball. Best move, worst move.
I started the debate. Knock your socks off.
All right. Now, the best offseason has to be the Oakland Athletics. Oakland Athletics have revamped their bullpen, which was actually strong to begin with. They traded a waste of life Jameel Weeks for Jim Johnson, who 2 years ago had about 50 saves with Baltimore. And then they traded Seth Smith, who was nothing more than a fourth outfielder, to the San Diego Padres for Luke Gregerson. They filled the hole with Smith by trading for Craig Gentry. And they've made a few of the nice moves here and there, signing Scott Kazmir to a two-year, $22 million contract. Billy Beane is really showing that he is smarter than everybody else. And he knows something that everyone else doesn't know, and that's how to win. You know what? They haven't made it past the first round in a while, but I think this is the year they're going to go all the way. Best moves.
All the way.
All the way.
Win the World Series.
Absolutely.
I got to write that down. Wow. You're predicting them to win the World Series.
I know. It's shocking. And worst moves. Atlanta Braves. What the hell are you doing? You let Tim Hudson go. You let McCann go. And to combat that, you signed Gavin Floyd, who didn't pitch last year. There's nothing good about your team right now. Jason Hayward's not. You don't know if Jason Hayward's going to bounce back. You have the Nationals in your division that traded for Doug Fister. They got one hell of a rotation. They had a lot of bad luck last year. You had the fortune of not having the Nationals at their best, and you lose your best players. Dan Uglis sucks. Jason Hayward's not going to turn it around. You have nothing to speak of.
Dan Uglis wasn't good since he played for the Marlins.
Yeah, he had 40 home runs last year, or 2 years ago. So, Oakland A's, best offseason. Atlanta Braves, worst offseason.
What's today's date?
Today's 12-13. Or, no, it's not. Today's 12-16.
12-16. We're going to make a new bet for this one. I don't know what, but we'll release the bet information come Wednesday. Oh,
come Wednesday, it's going to be a bet that's going to wait a year.
It's okay.
And you're going to, you better give me 1,000-to-1 odds because I'm betting now.
It's your problem.
Well, I don't have to agree to
it. We'll discuss it.
All right.
The best move of the offseason, I'm going to be extremely biased here. I like Brian McCann coming to the Yankees for a lot of different reasons. A, I've never liked Jorge Posada. I hated him. So
and
having Francisco, don't get me started. I will do a whole show on Jorge Posada.
You enjoy doing Jorge Posada. Okay. I heard you loud and clear. Perfect. All right. If you want to call us, 609-975-9689. Jimmy, continue. I'm sorry. My bad.
Thanks. Get to Old Street. So, anyways, best move, Brian McCann. I love it. I think the length of the contract was perfect, especially for his age. I think the money was perfect. The guy produces great numbers. I love it. Replacing Francisco Cervelli, who is among the rest, who did all the PEDs, the Yankees are not going to bring him back again. I'm very happy with this move. They're not going to put him in the lineup.
Francisco Cervelli's the backup catcher.
They'll put Stewart in there.
They traded Stewart.
He's still in the lineup, and they're going to trade him.
Chris Stewart's a pirate now.
Fantastic. I look like an asshole right now.
Not the first time.
I'll throw someone else in there before Francisco Cervelli. If they throw Francisco Cervelli in there, and they have A-Rod playing third, that'll look real bad.
Yeah.
Real bad. So, I do like McCann as the best move. This guy is finally a good defensive catcher that they've really wanted, who can also put up good offensive numbers.
Are you worried about the fact that he played like shit last year?
No, I'm not. I'm honestly not worried about that at all. When you're playing in the NL, everything is different when you go to the AL. That goes for every position player, whether you're a pitcher, you're a catcher, you play offense, defense, if you're a DH, everything, the leagues are so different from one another. And I really honestly like that he came to the Yankees. I think he's going to put up great numbers defensively. I'm not worried about his offense production. He's one of the top offensive catchers.
That's not saying much.
And you know what? I'm not gonna argue that. Because that's what I always say about Jorge Posada. He has the most doubles of any catcher. That doesn't say much. I don't care.
The only one that you can say that meant was Mike Piazza. Because he put up numbers like a real slugger.
So, going back to McCann. Wow. I do like
that. I want to pat myself on the back right there.
As far as one of the worst moves that I think was ever going down in baseball, I have to say Robbie Cano. One of the worst things ever. Seeing Robbie Cano, who doesn't deserve 10 years, who doesn't deserve $240 million, that is my worst move. Seeing all the fans hate him, him saying, I really didn't think they'd give me this much disrespect, and even Randall Levine didn't think they would give him that much disrespect. Guess what? We're New Yorkers. You're not. Speaking of New Yorkers, I'm sorry if I touched you, if you're looking at me like that. Speaking of New Yorkers, that line that Grandison used?
Oh, that's the best line.
Whoa!
Grandison is very well-spoken.
He is. He is. He absolutely is.
He knows what he's doing. He's much smarter than most of us.
I take that away
and
from him.
We have another call.
I take that away from him when he said what he said.
You're on the air with Jimmy and Steve.
Steve for a reason. I put that behind Steve incognito. I don't think he even saw that, but that is right behind him. I guess we're getting to Army Navy right now.
We can do that if you want.
I would take this one.
Alright.
The Army Navy game, what went wrong was that I know Navy also runs. If you could actually turn down the volume on your computer, that'd be great. But I know Army also, as well as Navy, they both run a triple option offense. So does Georgia Tech. Georgia Tech, who now you brought to my attention, actually leads the country in BCS in rushing. Army fired his coach, their coach Ellison.
Thanks. Yes, they did.
Yeah, they just fired their coach Ellison. Thank you for the call. We had a little bit of a delay back there. But I hope you still tune in. Army just recently fired their coach Ellison. I'm pretty happy about that. Now, that is a civilian's job, so they don't actually have to be a part of the military at all.
His son's part of the military.
Is he?
His son's on the team. His son's the long snapper.
Well, I don't have a problem with him, I guess. They don't really do much. I'm sick and tired of it. You know, my family had season tickets from before I was born until I was about 18 years old. No, 16 years old. We had season tickets. So you can imagine how many games I've seen. I've seen everybody in person from Randy Moss. I've seen quarterback McNabb. I've seen McNabb play.
Syracuse played Army?
Yeah.
Wow.
Unfortunately, I also saw Steve McNair play. So now all the players that I've seen also goes along saying all the teams that I've seen destroy Army. Why? Army runs a triple option offense. I guess it's a tradition thing. I don't know why they still do. Because it doesn't work.
Or
because
they don't get receivers to come to Army.
They can't recruit receivers, and they can't recruit a quarterback either.
Oh.
They can't, and it's terrible.
Why can't Navy? Keenan Reynolds looked ridiculous.
Keenan Reynolds set the BCS record.
29 touchdowns.
Unbelievable.
That game was... I don't watch college football that much because, quite frankly, college football is the bastard cousin to football because the options. I don't care about... The options the worst play in all of sports. But put that aside, I don't watch much college football, probably because my teams both suck. But Navy just rolled over them. And it really makes you wonder. Navy and Army are both military. What the hell is going on when Army can't have a winning season, yet Navy's making the bowls every year?
Army had a winning season a couple of years ago. They went to their first something stupid.com bowl
Brady.
Game. Yeah, .com bowl game, whatever the hell it was.
Every game's a .com bowl game because they're not making the BCS bowl.
They're not. Oh, no.
Ever.
Oh, no, never. Absolutely
the day they
not.
Do that, I am going to jump off your balcony, which is only one story, so don't worry.
You'll still die.
No.
So, no, they're never going to make another bowl game. And if they do, it's going to be one of those cheapo bowl games.
I said BCS.
Yeah, no, that's right. When they lost Santiago last year, I'm not going to stall. I forgot the quarterback's name from last year.
They didn't lose.
Trent Steelman. They lost Trent Steelman last year as a senior. He was a fantastic quarterback for them. He really was. He played very well for 4 years. Now they have this new guy, Angel Santiago, who
had a good year.
He's breaking their actual organization rushing records a year. And he's only a junior.
I'm sorry,
a sophomore.
He had the completion percentage of Eli Manning to his own receivers.
Yeah, that's true. You're absolutely right.
Not Eli Manning to other receivers.
And
that's 100%.
What showed was one of his three interceptions that he threw in the game. Lobbing it right over. Like, you know, he's shooting a three-pointer like Glenn Rice. You know, it was terrible.
Glenn Rice.
I loved him. I loved him. So just a little behind the back how he used to shoot. Army lost their 12th straight game.
Which is now 4,000.
I was just
going to
bring that up.
Days and cents.
I hate that. I'll talk about this. They said on the air, Army has not beaten Navy in over 4,000 days. You know that number. I don't. They played them, last time they won was 12 times ago. Okay, 12. 12 to 4,000. They don't have the opportunity to beat them every single day.
The last time they beat them, the iPod was created. iPod 1.
Okay, and
George Bush was president. I think the Twin Towers just went down.
But you know what? I will also say, they did actually. I will say this, like I told you. Let's say Army wins next year. They'll say at the 2015 game, Navy hasn't beaten Army in 365 days.
Bet
it
you they will not.
They won't say that, but they can say it because it means the same. You're throwing a number out there. They haven't beaten them in 365 days. Oh, my God.
It's just like to say Jimmy hasn't beaten Steven in debate in 65 days.
You got me sitting here wanting to do the math on this one. Now.
I have no idea. I just made up a fake number right there. You know, 45% of all stats are made up, including that one.
It's now 47%.
It's only 45.5.
I don't know. I think it's ridiculous and it's annoying. I'm a diehard Army fan and I hate to see Navy. Again, I posted something really nice. I thought, you know, really heartfelt. When you're watching an Army Navy game, you're going to want to stay out there. You're really going to want to watch that game and have the respect for both branches of military, especially Army.
Air
Force. I guarantee you don't know my rant. Especially Air Force. You have VMI. You have Texas A&M. All these military collegiate schools.
Texas A&M's a military school?
It is. Yeah.
It's a farming school.
I thought there are, or maybe Texas, Texas Tech. I thought Texas A&M. I know it's agriculture and mining, but
yeah.
I thought...
Virginia Tech's part military.
I know VMI is.
VMI is also military. I thought Texas A&M's a farming school. I think all the A&M schools are.
It would make sense, but one of the Texas schools I know is a military school.
Okay. Not TCU, right?
It was a good game. It was traditional Army football that a lot of people. I thought it was in this aspect. It was a traditional.
We turned it off
in
the
second. Shut up! The snow. I love the snow. I love watching an Army Navy game in the snow. It reminds me back when we used to actually have Army Navy college football game parties at my parents' house. When that game was a good game, when they would go back and forth year in and year out for who's going to win and who's going to lose. It was fun. I loved watching it. They brought it back this year to Philadelphia, as last year it was the M&T Bank Stadium. So I know you're a Navy fan.
I'm not. I just wanted to root against you.
Oh.
And it worked.
I know.
Because now you are a dirty Russian tonight.
I know.
And this type of drink. We should have had that.
A dirty Russian? A white Russian?
Same difference. No, which is Alexei Yashin.
Yeah, they're all dirty. Want to talk about basketball?
No.
Nobody cares about basketball.
Yeah, let's talk about hockey.
Mm-hmm.
So, it feels like last night was the first time that any New York team has won a regulation game. Because the Islanders did win an OT game against the Sharks last Thursday.
Rangers didn't win in regulation.
You're right, they didn't. I don't think there's been a regulation win in a month.
Yeah, it had to have been.
They are. Every New York team is awful.
Yeah.
But you know what the sad part is? There's a thing about the rules that happened this year when they switched two divisions. The top three teams in each division make the playoffs. Now, the Rangers are 1 point back at the third. And the Islanders, who haven't won a game in, I don't know.
Since the Stone Age.
Since the beginning of the season. Is only 8 points back of the third seed.
You say only.
That's not that much.
It is so difficult for them to get 1 point.
They've gotten points in the last two games.
That's... Go on.
Points in the last two games.
Unless you have anything to say about the Islanders, I am very dissatisfied with the Rangers. I have nothing to say about them right now at all. I'll give you the floor for the Islanders, because after that, I want to talk about the Boston Bruins.
Let's go to the Boston Bruins.
Okay. Sean Thornton, James Neal.
James Neal plays at Pittsburgh.
Sean Thornton for the Bruins, James Neal for the Penguins. When you saw this game, if you didn't watch it, when you saw the highlights, your initial reaction was what it was, but before they came out with the penalties, what were you thinking?
You mean the suspensions?
Yes. I'm having deja vu right now.
Yeah, I think it's a jersey. It's got to be. But no, you got to wear it for the rest of the show. You got 9 minutes.
I think I said that in the first episode, actually. I'm having deja vu. I might backtrack and look at that.
Yeah. Anyway, I actually think the punishments were fair. I think 5 games for Neil. You know what? The knee on knee hit was pretty dirty. But.
Knee on knee.
Knee on whatever he did.
Knee on face.
Knee on face.
Marchand, I wish it was a dirtier hit.
Marchand's not a clean player in his own mind.
No, but, I hate him so much.
But I think it was. I actually think it was a very fair hit. A very fair suspension. Not a fair hit. Sorry.
It was a fair hit.
It was a fair suspension. Thornton, he's scum. You don't fight somebody who doesn't want to fight back. You can't just punch him and sucker punch him and continue to fight him just for the hell of it. That's how injuries happen. Good work. Now, it's funny. I read something today. And sorry, my mouse is freezing.
That's cool.
They did a poll. Report did a poll a few years ago. Interviewed 13 Penguins. 12 of them said fighting belongs in the game. One of them said, no way, it's got to go out. The one who said it has to go out, not Sidney Crosby, Brooks Orpik.
Really?
Brooks Orpik. And look at him now. Now he's still... He didn't remember half that night. You don't attack a guy
I
just...
I wouldn't either.
Yeah. That was some hit. That really was.
He horse-collared him to the ground.
He did. It was a nice tackle.
The James Neal whole thing, I thought he was going to get 3 games for it. It was dirty. But you know what? As Brendan Shanahan, being as dirty as he ever was...
Oh, he was really dirty.
Yeah. Can't play a bias role anymore.
Why, Colin Campbell did it all the time.
I know he did. It is what it is. When I heard that James Neal was getting a phone call conference, I knew it was going to be 5 games. Mm-hmm. Because when you get a phone call conference, for anybody out there who doesn't know this, when you're going up for a suspension, once they release the information saying he's having a phone call hearing, your max suspension is 5 games. I knew it was at that point dirty enough where he's going to get the 5 games. Sean Thornton, I said he was going to get close to 25 games. He ended up getting 21 games. He got an official 15, but immediately after the game was suspended indefinitely until his hearing the following Monday, in which, I'm sorry, 19 games, in which they played four games in between. So, round that out, he got 20 games. I'm okay with that. I really am. I don't know if his apology was a very heartfelt apology.
No, he did. I gotta disagree with you there.
But the reason why I say that is because what he said in previous statements throughout the year, throughout last year, he was one of the guys who actually said fighting doesn't belong in the game. He's one guy who says, you know what, I believe in karma. What goes around comes around. You know, don't sucker punch anybody. It's going to come back to hurt you. He did exactly what he just said he doesn't do. So when you do that, that wipes out anything I ever thought good of the guy.
I'm going to quote Brandon Myers. It was in the heat of the moment, and stuff happens, you know.
As an ex-athlete, and I say ex.
Very loose, but yeah. I think that's loose. Those days are well gone.
Well, I can understand that. You're in the heat of the moment. I do recall one college fight where when I was a goalie, I got so pissed off, I didn't even feel like taking my blocker off. And I sucker punched this kid right in the face at the tip of my blocker. It felt so good.
Was that your last game of college hockey ever?
No, it wasn't, actually. It wasn't. Right. It was a real tough game to see. The Bruins are... I don't want to get heated right now because I'm saving that for the rant. The Bruins are a team I hate more than any team in all sports.
That's saying a lot, considering you hate the Islanders.
I do, but I don't hate them that much, and I don't hate the Jets as much as you think I do.
I don't think you hate the Jets at all. I think you love them. You're secretly a Jets fan.
Wearing a Jets shirt. Yeah, whatever this is.
You have a Mark Sanchez picture hanging in your closet.
Yeah, and someone had written Ed in my microphone box there. Mark Sanchez for MVP. Okay.
Absolutely. You know, the one thing I do hate, one thing I was discouraged about by Brandon Shanahan's punishments was how long it took.
Yeah, it took a long time.
Were you watching Ellen? Were you watching McCutcheon propose to his girlfriend on Ellen right there?
I agree, but I don't mind it because I want him to be suspended for a while.
I do mind it. You know what? Give him more up front. It's not as strong as you say you're suspended indefinitely and then you got a 15-game suspension. It'd be a lot worse if you suspend him, you miss 2 games, and you're out 20 games. It's the same amount, but does it sound stronger when I say you suspended 20 games as opposed to 15? Yeah. I think so.
I like what he did. This is me not being biased, really. I like what he did. I don't mind it. I was kind of confused, like, why is it taking so long? But you know what?
James, it's one of those things
It's one of those things with Thornton where maybe it was a whole mental aspect. You know what he had went through. You know, through his heartfelt apology, give him a couple of days to relax. Suspend him indefinitely. Keep him away from the organization. Keep him away from the team. Away from any activities.
He's suspended. He'd be away from the organization anyway. So what's the point of waiting?
If you're going to show the guy any respect, you would say to yourself, let this guy cool over.
The guy was in the freaking hospital.
I think Orpikov's got suspended also.
No!
For the play previous.
From Louis Erickson head? No, he didn't get suspended.
I thought he got a 1-game suspension.
No, he did not get suspended.
That'd be a sympathy. I'm taking that suspension away from me after what happened to you.
Yeah, he didn't get... That was a clean hit on Erickson. It was clean. But, you know what? We don't have much time, and everyone who's listening to this show, before we get into the dirty Russian rant, I mean Jimmy's rant, we will be having another show Wednesday in which we'll talk about Week 15 in football. We'll be talking about...
Fix this lighting over here, too, by the way. We'll do something about that.
I don't think anyone cares.
I will.
We'll be talking about the Jets' loss to the Panthers, the Giants... Well, I don't know what they did on Sunday to the Seahawks. That really wasn't much of anything. And we'll be talking about the playoff picture in the future. But, for now, Jimmy, you've been a good sport today wearing that jersey. It's about time that you lost a bet and had to pay up, so congratulations. But now, it's time for your rant.
Okay. Let's just start with this. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Now, I went to the Ranger game last night, sick as a dog still.
You got a phone number.
And, yeah, I did. I was happy about that.
I think that's a shocking thing about the entire night, more so than the Rangers winning.
You can write about that next week, all right?
Nah, okay.
So, last night's game. And I'm not going to rant about the Rangers winning because there's nothing there. However,
that's true.
In the in the first period, now I understand in February is going to be the Winter Olympics in Sochi, Russia.
Sochi.
Right, in Russia. The fans, halfway through the first period, were chanting, USA,
ooh.
USA, USA. I was getting effing pissed off because it goes to show. Now, I'm sure this is going to happen throughout the country at other stupid cities. And I'm saying New York is stupid when it comes to the Rangers. Ranger fans pissed me off so much last night. You morons! I'm saying this wearing an Islanders jersey. You're chanting USA. Guess what? Who's your favorite goalie? Henrik Lundqvist. Where's he from? He's from freaking Sweden!
I think you just blew out my speaker.
Awesome!
I'm just...
He's from Sweden. Carl Hagelin. He's from Sweden. Rick Nash. He's from Canada.
Whoa,
guess what?
Canada.
Half the other teams, half the other players, they're playing Canada last night. And they're playing Calgary. Half those players, okay, i.e. Moss. Who's some players on Calgary? I'm throwing a blind right
Jay
now.
Jay Bomeister from America.
Bomeister from America. There are players from both America, from Canada, from Sweden, from Germany. Who the hell are you chanting USA to? I know those Ranger fans out there saw Calgary coming in saying, USA, 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 screw Canada because you're Calgary. And I know it's also that time of year. It's the Winter Olympics. Any other time where a Canadian team comes in where it's not the year of the Olympics, you're not cheering USA, USA. Last night, you looked like freaking morons. That's it. Plain and simple. You look like morons. Cut this shit. Stop chanting USA. I'm American. I love it. If you're going to chant it last night, hell, chant it every freaking game, you fake idiots.
Alrighty. You know, I really wish I had proud to be an American to go right there, but I don't. But it's 9:01. I think we're over time today. For Jimmy, or the Dirty Russian, I'm Steve. You have yourself a great night. We'll see y'all again on Wednesday.
Bye.
Tomorrow's sun will build in this great sky.